Loibner-Waitkus. Okay, I'm Alan Loibner-Waitkus, and this is American Literature 1865 through present, and we were talking about Howl and Footnote to Howl. And originally, I was supposed to have a special guest from San Francisco, where City Lights Books, where this was published and originally read, came from, and he was going to help, but he bailed on me. So it's just going to be me, and this is a tough poem to teach, and I'll be honest up front. I like Footnote to Howl a lot. I'm not a real fan of Howl itself. And then there's a debate there. Is the footnote part? Is it part four, or is it a separate entity, or is it in itself a footnote? But we'll get to that a little later. What we're looking at is the Beats, and the reason I chose this is I felt you needed to read something from the Beats, and there are several Beat writers. The big three, you know, I'm sort of, that you hear a lot about and that I sort of focus on are Jack Kerouac, of course, who wrote On the Road. My favorite, William S. Burroughs, who wrote Naked Lunch, Junkie, Exterminator, Soft Machine, a lot of novels, and then of course Allen Ginsberg, who's the poet of the group, and then Lawrence Ferengali, who was the publisher of City Light Books in San Francisco, which is open to this day, and if you're ever in San Francisco, you can go in and kind of get the full experience. And you know, one of the things now that we're talking about the publishing, Lawrence Ferengali was arrested when this book was published for obscenity. The charge by the San Francisco police. The charges were eventually dropped, but it's really what brought this poem. The notoriety is really what brought it to the forefront, and it became sort of the anthem of the Beats and hippies at the time, and this counterculture movement. Now you have to remember, we're in the Cold War here. We are really sort of, you know, America is really pushing conformity, and you know, this whole June Cleaver sort of world where we vacuum in high-heeled shoes and everybody has to conform, and all of that. Now, Ginsberg had spent some time in a mental institution, a Presbyterian psychiatric ward in New York City with Carl Solomon, to whom the poem is dedicated, and the entire third part is about the So there's that aspect, and the poem is in three parts, and I'm really not going to go that heavily into the poem. It's really, you know, if you read through it, it's really sort of self-explanatory. As far as the structure goes, it's free verse, clearly, and it involves this anaphora for each of the three sections, which is another way. We have the determined poetry refrain, which is a repetition of words like Nevermore in The Raven by Edgar Allan Poe. To be anaphora, it's the beginning of lines that we repeat. And here in the opening, the first section, he repeats, you know, who. The second section, he repeats Moloch. And in the third section, he repeats, I'm with you in Rockland. So we see that as we move through. Now let's get into the poem itself. The first part is really discussing how he's seen the best minds of his generation, and whom he sees as, you know, the crazy people, the other artists and poets from his movement, Kerouac, Burroughs, Hunky, Cassidy, those people whom he names specifically in the footnote, you know, and what he's seen them suffer through by the government, other people, Main Street society, those sorts of things. Then in the second part, he focuses really on Moloch. Now, Moloch is, again, this group of people, the government, the conformists, materialism, all of these things are summed up by Moloch, who was a Canaanite god mentioned in the Bible, and children were sacrificed to him. So again, there's this idea that these people are being sacrificed to this pagan god Moloch, who represents again, the status quo in this country, and then those sorts of things. Then we move into, rather than mention the name of the insane asylum he was in, he changes the name to Rockland and uses that through the remainder of the poem. So, you know, that's a pretty concise overview. You know, he's really just getting to the crux of, again, steering away from that June Cleaver world, mentioning sex, drugs, all of those things that Americans had just sort of put their fingers in their ears and covered their eyes and pretended that weren't going on. And so, you know, interesting poem, needs to be taught, but really don't have as much to say about it as I do a lot of the other work. So I hope you enjoyed it. Now, the footnote is interesting to me, and I really do think the footnote is sort of brilliant. I like this idea that when he's mentioning things being holy, he mentions everything. You know, some words in there that we would consider obscene to seraphim, you know, angels, and that sort of thing. And I think that that's an interesting idea. I grew up, because everything he's saying is holy, and if God made something, it has to be holy. And I remember, I tell a story about when I was a kid. I have a very religious aunt and uncle, and they had just had a child. Well, I mean, just had. He was old enough where he was learning words, and you know, you do the whole, where is your ear? You know, and the kid grabs his ear, and everybody sort of claps, and they say, you know, who made your ear, and he would say, God did. And the, you know, where's your nose? And he'd point to his nose, and they say, who made your nose? And he said, you know, God did. And we go through sort of every body part, and then at some point they said, who made your, I don't remember the term that they used for, you know, his genital, or you know, asked him to point to it, and he did, and they said, you know, who made it? Or no, they didn't say that. Everybody kind of went silent, and so I just said, not thinking, I was really young, you know, who made whatever word they used, and I got a spanking, because that was inappropriate. But it was interesting to me as a child, because again, I didn't see that as dirty, and, you know, I thought, well, if God made everything else, so did he made those parts too. And I think that that's what Ginsberg, in a way, I mean, I hate to oversimplify, but I think that's what Ginsberg, in a way, is doing in the footnote, is sort of saying, you know, again, if the seraphim's going to be holy, so is the bum. You know, if this part of the body, if the nose is holy, so are, you know, the genitals. And so it's a little shocking and a little disconcerting to some people, but I do think it is really beautifully written. And so what I'm going to end with here is, I posted the video earlier, but what I've done is taken Patti Smith, the rock and roll, she's in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, a very well-known singer-songwriter. She recorded on one of her albums, The Footnote, to music, didn't sing it, talks through it, reads it as a poem. She recorded it under the title Spell, but, you know, gives him credit, and the opening of a book of her collected works are, The epigraph is a quote from Footnote to Howl. So she really, really loved Howl. And if you like Patti Smith and are interested in this, she won the National Book Award for her autobiographical book called Just Kids, about her growing her life with the famous photographer Robert Mapplethorpe. So if you're interested in Patti Smith, you might want to check that out, or check out some of her other recordings, and give William S. Burroughs a shot. Maybe read On the Road by Kerouac. I would suggest, if you're going to read something bigger by the Beats, you start with Junkie by William S. Burroughs. I think it's the most accessible of the books. So if you have any questions, give me a call. I'm sure a lot of you are shocked that we read this in class, but hey, it's in your textbook and needs to be read. So if you have any questions, call me.
Everybody's holy, everywhere is holy, Every day is an eternity. Every man is an angel. The bum is as holy as the seraphim. The madman as holy as you, my soul, holy. The typewriter is holy. The poem is holy. The voice is holy. The hearers are holy. The ecstasy is holy. Holy Peter, Holy Alan, Holy Solomon, Holy Lucian, Holy Kerouac, Holy Hunky, Holy Burroughs, Holy Cassidy, Holy the unknown buggered and suffering beggars, Holy the hideous human angels, Holy my mother in the insane asylum, Holy the cops at the grandfathers of Kansas, Holy the groaning saxophone, Holy the holies, Holy the jazz bands, marijuana hipsters, peace and junk and dreams. Holy the solitudes of skyscrapers and pavements. Holy the cafeterias filled with the millions. Holy the mysterious rivers of tears under the streets. Holy the lone juggernaut. Holy the vast lamb of the middle class. Holy the crazy shepherds of rebellion. Who digs Los Angeles is Los Angeles. Holy New York, holy San Francisco, holy Peoria, Seattle, holy Paris, holy Tangier, holy Moscow, holy Istanbul, holy time and eternity, body, holy eternity and time, holy the clocks and space, holy the fourth dimension, holy the fifth international, holy the angel and Moloch, holy the sea, holy the desert, holy the railroad, holy the locomotive, holy the visions, holy the hallucination, holy the miracles, holy the eyeball, holy the abyss, holy forgiveness, mercy, charity, faith, holy ours, body, suffering, magnanimity, holy the supernatural, extra brilliant, intelligent, kindness of the soul.
Jesus died for somebody's sins, but not mine. Milton, pot of thieves, wild cord on my sleeve. Thick, heart of stone, my sins my own, they belong to me. Me. People say beware, but I don't care. The words are just rules and regulations to me, me. Look at the wind.